Well, welcome back, folks, to another episode of the history of the music of the 1950s and 60s, or as I like to say, it's the soundtrack of our youth. So as always, let's let Bob Seger kind of get us started. Okay, I thought I'd kind of make sure and make you aware of the next few weeks because it's going to be a little bit different. Next Monday, December 18th, of course, is the Monday before Christmas. And I'm going to kind of break, what I've been doing and do just some Christmas music. Now, there'll be some, hymns, but basically it's going to be secular Christmas music because that's kind of what I'm doing here. I know Dwayne. Pastor Dwayne on his Bible study is going to be doing some things on the more of the hymns. And then Monday, December 25th, of course, is Christmas Day, so there will not be a presentation. And Monday, January the 1st, is New Year's Day, so there won't be a presentation. So that means that we'll resume our presentations on the history of the music in the 1950s and 60s on Monday, January the 8th. But I encourage you to tune in next Monday. I've got some really great Christmas songs and videos for you to watch, and I think you'll enjoy it. So let's kind of review what we did last week. Well, last week we saw how the Brill Building sound developed by Don Kirshner kind of revolutionized pop music. He kind of brought a new sophistication to the old bubblegum music. But it was much better than some of that bubblegum music of the late 1950s was. He had some really good songwriters. And he kind of had a philosophy that if you wanted teenagers to listen to the music, you need to find teenagers or early 20-year-olds to write it. And so he went out and found him a stable of songwriters that were just really kind of a who's who, including, really Carole King and Neil Sedaka. And Burt Bacharach, just a ton of really important singer-songwriters of the 1960s and later. At the top of that list probably had to be Neil Sedaka. He just had a spectacular career in the early 60s. He had some of the biggest songs of that era, Breaking Up Is Hard to Do, Happy Birthday, Sweet 16, Calendar Girl. We listened to all those last week. Of course, Carole King was another one, and she was just maybe the premier songwriter of the Brill Building sound. And she just had so many hits and still does. I mean, she is still going strong. Probably her biggest hit of the 1962 year was the Chiffons' He's So Fine. Then we saw how Bobby Benton kind of was back in that old teen idol mode. He could actually sing. In fact, because he was a very good instrumentalist and had a degree in music composition from Duquesne University. His big hit was Roses Are Red. And then we saw the rise of the Four Seasons, who, of course, was one of the biggest groups of the 1960s. They and the Beach Boys kind of were the two American groups that kind of survived the British invasion, which we're going to be talking about in about another month and a half. The British just about wiped out American music for a couple of years, but the Beach Boys and the Four Seasons kind of kept going. Then we saw how Shelley Fabre did what Ricky Nelson did. She was starring in the TV show, The Donna Reed Show. And the producers decided to let her sing a song called Johnny Angel on it. And it just propelled her career more into the movie star than the singing star. Really, that was her only big singing hit. But she ended up starring in three Elvis movies, which, pretty big deal back in the 60s. And then on top of that, she married Lou Adler, who was one of the biggest producers of television and movies and singing in the 1970s and 80s, and they kind of became a power couple. in America for that decade. So anyway, let's listen to our or look at our trivia question for today, and it's a pretty good one. 1962 saw Pat Boone have one of his biggest hits of the year with his recording of a novelty song. See if you can remember what the novelty song was that he recorded in 1962. Well, if you guessed, it was Speedy Gonzales. You were correct. 1962 saw Pat Boone sing a novelty song, Speedy Gonzales, which became the number two best-selling single of the year. Amazing. The song, written by a man by the name of David Hess, actually utilized the voice of Mel Blanc, who was kind of the cartoon voice of all the Warner Brothers cartoons, of which Speedy Gonzales was one of them. By the way, Warner Brothers actually sued Mel Blanc and Pat Boone for a copyright infringement, but they later dropped the case because it really was a kind of a stupid suit. So let's listen to Pat Boone sing Speedy Gonzales.
It was a moonlit night in old Mexico. I walked alone between some old adobe haciendas. Suddenly, I heard the plaintive cry of a young Mexican girl. You better come home, Speedy Gonzales, away from Tannery Row. Stop all of your drinking with that flusy name Flo. Come on home to your adobe and slap some mud on the wall. The roof is leaking like a strainer. There's loads of roaches in the hall. Speedy Gonzales, why don't you come home? Speedy Gonzales, how come you leave me all alone?
Hey, Rosita, I have to go shopping downtown for my mother. She needs some tortillas and chili pepper.
Your dog is gonna have a puppy, and we're running out of coal. No enchiladas in the icebox, and the television's broke. I saw some lipstick on your sweatshirt. I smell some perfume in your ear. Well, if you're gonna keep on messing, don't bring your business back here. Speedy Gonzales, why don't you come home? Speedy Gonzales, how come you leave me all alone?
Hey, Rosita, come quick. Down at the cantina, they're giving green stamps with tequila.
Okay, so there was Speedy Gonzales by Pat Boone, a number two best-selling song of 1962. Unbelievable. Okay. Well, we looked a couple of weeks ago at the surf music that had started out in California. Spent a whole hour on it, 45 minutes. And I haven't mentioned it anymore since then. But 1962 really saw it getting going and going nationwide. Up to that point, it kind of been more of a regional thing out on the West Coast. But then in 1962, the Beach Boys really kind of got going strong, as you will see. 1963, they just really became very, very important. In fact, it's probably one of the best-selling music groups of that era. June of 1962, the Beach Boys finally released their first single, Surfin' Safari. Much better than their first song, by the way, which on the flip side had a what was called a hot rod song, 409. for Capitol Records and was an immediate hit, reaching 14 on the Billboard pop chart. First single record to reach a national audience opened the door for surf music craze to go really nationwide. And with the popularity of the two singles, Capitol rushed an album out in October named Surf and Safari. And unlike most of the albums of the era, it consisted primarily of original songs and mostly about surfing and hot rods. Brian Wilson and Mike Love wrote almost every one of them. And although they were kind of simple under construction, the harmony of the Beach Boys really started showing and the mixing of their voices. And that kind of became the focal point of their music with their harmony. They kind of resorted back to the old groups of the 1950s with that. In addition, most surf songs up to this point had been instrumentals. Now they begin to be vocals. By the way, the Beach Boys were not exactly accepted by the local surfing community. In fact, the case, when they would do concerts, the surfers would actually show up and they would express their displeasure at what they considered to be these posers and throw vegetables and fruit at them. The surfing community didn't exactly like the Beach Boys. The only one the Beach Boys actually surfed was Dennis, you know. The flip side of Surf and Safari was 409, which kind of started another kind of craze, the hot rod craze. In a premonition of Brian's obsession with special effects later in his career, and he was obsessed with those, he set up a tape recorder and recorded one of his neighbors racing up and down the street in his hot rod, which had, as it said in the song, a four-speed, dual quad, positive traction, 409 engine, just like Mike Love sang about in the song. So here is their first really nationwide single that really hit big, which is Surf and Safari, much better than their first song.
Let's go surfing now, everybody's learning how. Come on a safari with me.
Another big thing that took place in 1962 was another year of these big novelty songs. Seemed like there was a whole bunch of them. As we've already saw with Speedy Gonzales, they were pretty popular. One of the biggest ones was a skit from an old Borscht Belt comedian by the name of Alan Sherman. He wrote a song called Hello Mother, Hello Father. I bet some of you remember that for sure. Based on the letter he had received from his son while he was attending one of these summer camps. It was so good and so successful that the only reason it didn't hit number one was because Stevie Wonder's Fingertips Part 2 kept it off, did win a Grammy for the best comedy performance. Another one, of course, was The Ballad of Jed Clampett by Lester Flatt and Earl Scruggs. It had been written by Earl Hinnings as the theme song for the Beverly Hillbillies, which was one of the biggest TV shows in the 1960s. And then, of course, we had The Monster Mash, written and performed by Bobby Boris Pickett. And you can hear it every Halloween. It comes back on the radio. And, you know, it's played constantly. You know, it's one of those songs that just won't go away. But the biggest one, without a doubt, was The First Family, which was a comedy album on the life, based on the life of the very popular new president, President Kennedy. I know some of you remember this because it absolutely sold like crazy. It was done by a stand-up comedian impressionist, a guy by the name of Von Meter, who absolutely, I remember when these came out and we listened to him, and I mean, he sounded just like President Kennedy. You're going to hear him in a minute. It became the fastest selling album in recording history. Within 3 weeks, it had sold 3 million copies. I want to repeat that. Within 3 weeks, it had sold 3 million copies. Eventually sold over 7 million copies. Giving you an idea how big that is, the best-selling comedy record in the last 50 years was Jeff Foxworthy, You Might Be a Redneck, and it didn't even come close to selling as much as Von Meter's did in 7 weeks. I mean, it was just an unbelievable hit. Of course, we all know what happened. The next year, President Kennedy, unfortunately, was assassinated, and that ended the career of Von Meter, to say the least. You know, because they just absolutely could not do anything else then at that point. So I thought I'd play you just one of the little skits out of it. It's a comedy. It's not a singing thing. It's a comedy skit. And this happens to be a skit where President Kennedy has got together a bunch of the leaders of the world called the Economy Lunch. And I think it's one of his funniest skits. It features all the big leaders of the world, and most of the new people wouldn't have any idea what this is all about. But you that were living at this time, you know what's going on. So let's listen to it.
Do you really think you can get away with this?
Well, Pierre, I've been criticized in the newspapers for the big parties and the state dinners. Now, we've got to cut down in economy starch at home.
All right, if you say so. Oh, here they are.
All right, gentlemen, let us be seated. Mr. Adenauer, if you will sit next to your friend, Mr. de Gaulle. And Mr. Castro, if you will sit here next to your friend, Mr. Khrushchev. Mr. Nasha, if you will sit here next to Mr. Ben-Gurion. I'm sorry. Mr. Nkrumah, if you will sit in between Mr. Ben-Gurion and Mr. Nasha, then you can turn either way. Now, Mr. Chiang Kai-shek, would you please sit there beside Mr. Khrushchev? Oh, good. Now, before we get down to the business at hand, I think lunch would be in order. Now, I thought that instead of the formal food we usually serve here, that we would have a typical American businessman's lunch. So I'm going to send down to the delicatessen store for some sandwiches. Well, how does that strike you, gentlemen? Mr. Khrushchev, would you, I appreciate your enthusiasm, but would you mind just taking your shoe off the table? Now, I think I'll have a peanut butter and jelly on whole wheat with a side order of a coleslaw and a hot fudge sundae. Mr. de Gaulle?
Yuck. I would like to have Dove under glass.
Well, I'm sorry, General, but we're only having sandwiches today.
Then could I have a Dove under glass sandwich?
All right, Pierre, a chicken salad on white for the General. Mr. Chiang Kai-shek.
Club sandwich would be fine. Thank you so much.
Would you like it with a little mayo?
Please, not to mention that name.
I'm sorry. Mr. Nasha.
I'll have a hot pastrami sandwich. I can never get it at home.
What kind of bread?
White toast with lettuce and mayonnaise.
Mr. Nasha.
What do you want, Ben-Gurion?
Look, I know we don't get along. You never listen to me. Now you're fooling around with rockets. But this time, please listen. Pastrami don't go with white bread and lettuce and mayonnaise. Have it on rye bread with mustard and a glass of tea, you'll enjoy.
I think that Mr. Ben-Gurion has your point there.
All right, I'll take a chance.
Good boy. And if you like pastrami, next time you're in my neighborhood, drop into the house. My wife makes a gefilte fish. It melts in your mouth.
We'll have to get together, Mr. Ben-Gurion.
My name is Ben-Gurion. You can call me Ben.
My name is Abdul Nasser. You can call me Abe.
Good. Now, fine. Mr. Khrushchev.
Oh, you don't have to order special for me. I'll have a bite of everybody else's.
All right, Mr. Adenauer.
You have one sandwich here in America I love. I have a Western sandwich.
If Adenauer has a Western sandwich, then I'll have an Eastern sandwich.
There is no Eastern sandwich.
Then I want the Eastern portion of his Western sandwich.
I'm sure we can negotiate on that subject. Mr. Castro.
No pregunte qué su patria puede hacer para usted. Pero pregunte qué usted puede hacer para su patria. I have a chicken sandwich with a live chicken.
Well, that leaves Mr. Nkrumah. What will you have, sir?
I'll have some watermelon.
Don't put me on, Mr. Nkrumah.
All right, a ham and egg sandwich and a Coke. And I guess a bowl of borscht.
Okay, Pierre, put the rush on it. Well, gentlemen, that was a pleasant lunch. Now, under discussion today will be nuclear disarmament, followed by the UN bond issue and a matter of the trade agreements. Now, first, there is a most important matter to settle. Mr. De Gaulle, yours was the chicken salad and coffee. That's $1.40. 15 cents per strip.
Okay, enough of that. Like I said, younger people wouldn't get this, but I think probably most of us would. By the way, kind of politically incorrect anymore. You probably couldn't get away with some of the things that Von Meter did in the early 60s. Well, let's switch gears. Let's talk about country songs of 1962. Some pretty important country songs came about. Number 10, probably one of them, Rex Allen, Don't Go Near the Indians. I don't even remember that. PT 109 by Jimmy Dean. Old River by Walter Brennan. Well, I remember that. Crazy by Patsy Cline, of course, was a fantastic song. Adios Amigo by Jim Reeves. I've Been Everywhere by Hank Snow. She's Got You, Patsy Cline also. She Thinks I Still Care by George Jones. Huge song. Devil Woman by Marty Robbins. And the number one country music song of 1962 was Wolverton Mountain by a guy by the name of Claude King. We're going to hear that in a few minutes. So, let's talk about one of the biggest albums that came out in 1962. It was kind of a country music album. I say kind of, because it was made by Ray Charles. Now, Ray Charles, as I've already talked to you about, hated to be put in a box. I mean, every time somebody would try to say, okay, Ray Charles is a rhythm and blues singer, he'd say, no, I think I'm going to sing rock and roll. And then they say, well, he's a rock and roll singer. He said, nope, I'm going to go back to gospel. He just absolutely defied description. And so in 1962, when he came out with a new album called Modern Sounds in Country and Western Music, people were scratching their head. They said, what? Ray Charles singing country music? Well, of course, the country music he sang were old standards, and like Hank Williams and some of these. But he reworked them into his special style. And folks, it is probably, by critics, they They say that this is one of the absolute best albums ever made in music. And I used to own this album. I don't anymore. I don't have any vinyl records at all. But I remember this song. I mean, it was just a fantastic album. I mean, he would take country standards and turn them on their head in his old-fashioned way. So look at some of them. He had four singles that end up hitting gold off this record: Born to Lose, Careless Love, You Don't Know Me, and I Can't Stop Loving You. All of them went gold. Of course, I Can't Stop Loving You was the biggest. Originally written and recorded by Don Gibson. We've already listened to that. Was a best-selling single of the year. Spent 5 weeks at number one. Won a Grammy Award for the best rhythm and blues recording, even though it was on a country music album. Like I said, you know, Ray Charles just could not be, put in a box. Some people say this is one of the best ever records recorded, saying you can literally feel the pain of heartbreak in Ray Charles's phrasing of the words in I Can't Stop Loving You. So let's listen to this great rendition of this song by Ray Charles.
When I try to go to sleep and know that I won't lie awake and cry, baby, then I'll be over you. And when I wake up, morning, and I find you're not on my mind, baby. You're not on my mind. You're not on my mind. That's when I know I'll be over you one day, but right now
I can't stop loving you. I've
made up my mind to live in memory. I'm alone sometimes. Oh,
I can't stop wanting you.
Hear me, it's useless to say. No, I'll just live my life and talk to you.
Feel so broken.
in dreams of yesterday.
Okay, just a great, great song. Great song anyway, but it's a great song when Ray Charles sings it for sure. Well, we've already talked about George Jones. George Jones broke out in the late 1950s with a song that he had recorded and called White Lightning, written by the Big Bopper. And I'm telling you, he really started going strong in 1962. He was another star that didn't quite jive with Nashville. He kind of went his own way. Part of it was because, I'll be honest with you, he had some substance abuse problems, and Nashville kind of just turned off. But they couldn't turn off too much on him because he was such a big seller of country music. He was much more traditional than, obviously, Ray Charles. We already know a little bit about him. Born in a big thicket region of southeast Texas. Grew up idolizing Roy Acuff, Bill Monroe. It's said that his alcoholic father would come home at night after a night out of carousing and drinking and wake George up and make him sing. And if he wouldn't sing, it'd beat him. And as one psychologist put it, he had to sing. Well, he kind of felt that way the rest of his life. He felt like he just had to sing. Of course, we all know, like I said, he had a lot of substance abuse problems of his own. Left home by 16. Began working at one of the local radio stations, met Hank Williams, and from there it just went on. Had a nickname. He was called the Possum because of his nose and kind of beady eyes, you know, and he kind of adopted that. He didn't care. People started calling him look like a possum. He said, I don't care, I do kind of look like a possum, don't I? Went on the Louisiana Hayride, tried to sing rockabilly for a while, like I said, finally found his niche in drinking songs. Now, that's kind of ironic because that was his downfall in a lot of ways, because he was a big drinker and really developed a reputation as no-show Jones because, you know, he was so frequently absent from his shows. Finally went into rehab in 1967, the first of many stints in rehab. But this is his first big song that recorded in 1962. This is him singing it in 1970. She Thinks I Still Care.
Just because I ask a friend about her, just because I spoke her name somewhere, just because I rang her number by mistake today, she thinks I still care. Just because I haunt the same old places where the memory of her just because I'm not the happy guy I used to be, she thinks I still care. She thinks I
okay, so that was George Jones singing his first big hit in 1962. Now, I'm going to go ahead and talk a little bit about George Jones because, you know, he kind of falls out of the parameters of what we're doing, but I think it's important. Of course, that was recorded. That was a video we done in 1970. That's the year that he met and married his second wife, who was Tammy Wynette. Now, if you know anything about George Jones and Tammy Wynette, you know that they had a tumultuous and chaotic relationship, to say the least. She tells the story that one time she hid all of his keys so he wouldn't go buy any liquor, and he hopped on his lawnmower and drove 10 miles to the nearest bar so he could, it was just, that's the kind of marriage they had. She ended up being codependent with him herself, had her own addiction problems. But they made great music together. That was the ironic thing. They actually had some of the biggest hits of the 1970s. They soon divorced, and Jones spiraled out of control even further, got really addicted to cocaine. And somehow he continued his career, even though he would frequently not show up. It just, it was amazing that he was able to even do anything. Then in 1980, he released a song called He Stopped Loving Her Today, and it just absolutely rejuvenated his career. It was about that time that he met another woman that he eventually married, Nancy Sepulveda, who had a massive impact on his career. She cleaned up his finances, kept him away from his drug dealers. By the way, there's a story goes that they actually kidnapped her daughter to try to let him go see the drug dealers, and she wouldn't do it. I don't know how much truth there is. There's some people who think that's not a true story. Within a few years, he had actually finally got his act together, and he actually went back out, and all those concerts that he had not shown up at, that people paid for him to see, to see him, he actually made them up for free. He felt really bad about what he had done, and so he went back out and kind of tried to do his best to kind of make amends. Unfortunately, his records came fewer and fewer. He ended up dying in 2013 at the age of 81. But his funeral was just attended by almost every living country music superstar. He was, folks, as I said right at the beginning, if there was a Mount Rushmore of country music stars, George Jones would probably be on it. He's that big a deal with the country music fans. So let's listen to him sing his last big hit and one of his best. He Stopped Loving Her Today.
He said, I'll love you till I die. She told him, forget it. I watched the years pass slowly by. She still prayed upon his mind. Kept her picture on his wall. Went half crazy now, but he still loved her through it all. Kept hoping she'd come back again. They found love letters by his bed, dated 1962. He had underlined in red every single I love. I went to see my friend today. Oh, and I didn't see no tear. All dressed up to go away. First time I'd seen smiling years. He stopped loving her today. They placed a ring upon his door. Soon they'll carry him away. He stopped loving her today. You know she came back today for a last time. Oh, and we all wondered if she would. And it kept running through my mind. Well, this time, he's over her for good. He stopped loving her today. They placed a ring upon his door. Soon they'll carry him away. But he stopped loving her today.
Okay, kind of sad. You can tell the ravages of the alcohol and drugs have taken his voice there. That was done in the 80s. But, you know, people loved him anyway, kind of like Elvis. You know, even when Elvis was at his worst, people would, you know, go to his concerts and, you know, applaud him. So one last song, Wolverton Mountain, Claude King. You know, country music's never been a one-hit wonder type movie genre, like maybe rock and roll. There's tons of one-hit wonders in rock and roll. In country music, once fans find somebody they like, they continue buying their records. Well, if there's ever a song that deserves to be called a one-hit wonder in country music, it's got to be Wolverton Mountain. It was sung by a man by the name of Claude King. You know, he started off as a session artist, backup singer during the Louisiana Hayride. Was on the same programs as Elvis, Hank Williams, Webb Pierce, Farron Young, George Jones, many others. Finally moved to Nashville, continued on as a session player and a songwriter. Never really had a big career of his own. But one day he sat down with a Nashville veteran, a guy by the name of Merle Kilgore. You know country music, know Merle. He had helped him write a song called Wolverton Mountain, which was based on Kilgore's reclusive uncle, Clifton Clowers. There really was a Clifton Clowers who lived on Wolverton Mountain in rural North Arkansas. And after King recorded the song, it just went crazy. I mean, people loved the song. Crossed over top 10 hit on the pop charts, besides being number one on the country charts. And that was it. No more for Claude King. This was his only big song. But it was the number one country music song of 1962 and was a top 10 song at one point on the pop chart. So let's listen to Wolverton Mountain.
They say don't go on Wolverton Mountain if you're looking for a wife. 'Cause Clifton Clowers has a pretty young daughter. He's mighty handy with a gun and a knife. Her tender lips,
her tender lips
are sweeter than honey. And Wolverton Mountain protects her there. The bears and the birds tell Clifton Clowers, if a stranger should enter there, all of my dreams are on Wolverton Mountain. I want his daughter for my wife. I'll take my chances and climb that mountain. Though Clifton Clowers, he might take my life. Her tender lips,
her tender lips
are sweeter than honey. And Wolverton Mountain protects her there. The bears and the birds tell Clifton Clowers, if a stranger should wander there, I'm going up on Wolverton Mountain. It's too lonesome down here below. It's just not right to hide his daughter from the one who loves her so.
Her tender lips, are sweeter than honey. And Wolverton Mountain protects her there. The bears and the birds tell Clifton Clowers, if a stranger should wander there. But I don't care about Clifton Clowers. I'm gonna climb up on his mountain. I'm gonna take the girl I love. I don't care about Clifton Clowers. I'm gonna climb up on that mountain and I'll get the one I love.
Okay, well, that's enough for today. Well, I want to remind you again, next week, I'm not going to be doing 50s and 60s music. I'm going to do Christmas music. And most of it's going to be from pop artists. You'll recognize some of them. I'm going to leave the hymns to Pastor Duane. I'll have a few in there. I've got a few hymns, but most basically we're going to be doing secular music as far as Christmas songs. I think you'll enjoy it. You'll really like it. And then again, Monday, Christmas Day, Monday, New Year's Day, of course, we won't be broadcasting. So I will see you back then to continue for looking at 50s and 60s music on January the 8th, Monday. So I appreciate it. I hope you've enjoyed it. And I will see you then.